Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to this session on overheads. So today we are going to talk in detail about overhead accounting, basically a part of cost accounting. We've already done a lot of discussion on areas related to indirect expenses, indirect wages, whether it's indirect material, labor or expenses. But these three things combined are called as overheads, and we're going to study these overheads in detail today in order to understand what kind of questions can be asked in the examination. Okay, it's very difficult. Let me be very honest. Overheads, if you get into the technicalities of overheads, it gets very difficult. However, you're not expected to cover overheads in such great depth for this examination. You need to have a very basic fundamental understanding of overheads so that you can answer those tricky small questions correctly. Okay, there are a lot of areas from where in which overheads can get a lot tricky, and therefore it's expected that you understand the fundamentals of overheads, only that, not expected to get into the details of overheads. Before starting, or the first thing that I want to do when I start with this session on overheads, is to take an example, because without an example, overheads is going to be a very difficult job for you. With an example, overheads is going to become very easy for you to understand. Okay, this example will actually fulfill majority of the needs of this session. The question says Cadila company has three production departments ABC. So these are three production departments. Please remember, there are two different kinds of departments, production departments in a company, where the primary production of the product is going on. For example, if I am a service provider, then the primary production for me is content. Content creation, teaching to you guys is the primary responsibility or the primary activity of my business. That means my production department will be, one of my production departments will be creating videos, creating sessions for you guys. And these two are service departments. Service departments are departments which help in the better functioning of the production departments. For example, sales, marketing in my case, tech support in my case, all these are service departments because they are not directly connected with what is being provided to you, but they improve the quality of what is being provided to you, which is basically teaching, right? So I've explained to you the meaning of production department and service department from a service company point of view, so that it becomes all the more clear. For production companies, it's very clear. You're creating, going back to biscuits, you're creating biscuits. Creation of production of manufacturing of biscuits will come under production department, any department involved in that. Service department will be, let's say, accounting, administration, selling, distribution, all those will be service departments. Okay. It says Cadila company has three production departments and two service departments. The following figures are extracted. Allocate and apportion overheads. Please go through this carefully. Understand this. We have to allocate only overheads. What are overheads? All the indirect costs. All the indirect costs. So all the direct costs will be ignored and only indirect costs will be taken into consideration. Okay. Now what are the costs? We have, first of all, rent and rates, indirect wages, depreciation of machinery, general lighting, power. These are all indirect costs. There are some other costs, I believe. Floor space, total 10,000, and this is the allocation. Light points, the allocation. Direct wages. Direct wages is a direct cost, not an indirect cost. Okay. Horsepower of machinery, it's not in rupees. Value of machinery, it's again a direct cost, 2,50,000 and so forth. It's a direct cost, it's not an indirect cost. Therefore, allocation of direct cost will not happen for the production departments because they come under direct expenses. However, whatever allocation of direct costs is there in the service departments, that will be considered as an indirect cost for that service department, because service departments don't have any direct costs. All their costs are overheads only. For example, even if I have an accountant, or let's say a team of accountants and auditors whom I am paying certain amount of money, it is a service department, but whatever costs are allocated to that service department in the name of, let's say, legal charges, accounting charges, or auditing charges. All of them are indirect costs only. Okay. Therefore, the costs, these two costs, value of machinery, direct wages, will be allocated in service department. Value of machinery, because it's an asset, it's a long-term cost, it's not a recurring cost, therefore it is going to be ignored. It is not going to be taken into consideration because it's not a recurring cost, it's a one-time cost. Okay, now let's come to the answer. How exactly are we going to allocate costs? We have to allocate all these costs. What is overhead allocation? We have to allocate all these costs to these departments. Matlab, total of 5,000 rupees was spent on rent and rates. Now, the responsibility of the overhead accountant or the cost accountant is to allocate this to the service department. Okay, to allocate this to the service department and show what is the allocation to department D, how much of this 5,000 will be the responsibility of department D, how much will be the responsibility of department E, and so forth. Okay. So this is how the allocation is being done. Let me explain to you what happens in overheads. Direct wages, as I said, will not be allocated for A, B and C. Why? Because it is a direct expense. But for D and E, whatever expenditure is done on direct wages is going to be an indirect expense. There, 1500 and 500, therefore it is going to be allocated in the same proportion. Now, this is the tricky area. Okay, rent and rates. On what basis are you going to distribute rent among different departments? Rent kaise hota hai? Rent is always based on the area. The bigger apartment I have, the bigger factory I have, the more rent I'm going to be paying. The smaller factory I have, the smaller work warehouse I have, the less rent I'll be paying, right? So it will be based on floor space. Now let's go back to the question. Floor space is here. Floor space. Total 10,000, this is the allocation given. Okay, so it is 20% here, 25% here, 30% here, as a percentage of total total expenditure on floor space. 20% here and 5% here. What is the total rent and rates? 5,000. Half of 10,000, so half of all this will be allocated. I hope it's clear. Okay, so what is going to happen here? One second, let me remove this. Okay, floor space 1000, because there was 2000 there, 20%. 20% of 5000 will be 1000. Similarly, the allocation will go up based upon the floor space allocation. Okay. Next is general lighting. Now, what is general lighting? General lighting is the expenditure here. General lighting, 600 expenditure of general lighting. What will be the basis of allocation? Lighting, ho rahi hai, matlab light points. Clearly, dikh raha hai. Based upon light points, only the allocation of general lighting will be made. This is given total 60, this is 10, 10 upon 60, 15 upon 60, 20 upon 60, 10 upon 60, 5 upon 60. This is the basis of allocation of general lights. Okay. Now 60, 600, that means 10 times. So we'll multiply all of this by 10, it'll be easier for us. Okay. And the same is being done here. 100, 150, 200, 150, 10 times of all this. Okay. Now you have indirect wages. On what basis will you divide or allocate indirect wages? On the basis of actual wages, direct wages. This is the allocation given, and you will divide the entire indirect wages, 1500, on the basis of same percentage allocation. Okay. The same thing is being done here. Indirect wages, the basis of allocation is direct wages, and the same percentage is going to be followed. Then you have power. Power is to be allocated based upon horsepower of machines. The more horsepower one department is using, the more it is contributing to the expense of power, right? Let's say the production department has 10 horsepower of machine, whereas the administrative department has 10 computers, which together form, let's say, one computer is 60 watt, so 600 watt, not even 1 kilowatt, okay? So horsepower of machine is much less in case of administration department, and therefore the allocation of power or lighting is also going to be proportionate. Power is done. I hope it's clear. The next is depreciation of machinery. Depreciation of machinery, kaam par hai? Depreciation of machinery, rupees 10,000 based upon value of machinery. Value of machinery is an asset, and therefore that is not going to be allocated. What is the allocation method? The allocation is done through depreciation of machinery. 10,000 is the depreciation, we'll divide it according to the same division of value of machinery. Okay, and adding this, you will get allocation of total overheads to the different departments. That is the objective of overheads. What is the confusion in overheads? What is the problem in overheads and what is being solved? The problem is that all these expenses we get for the entire company. We always get electricity expense for the entire company. We always get depreciation of a lot of things which are used by various departments. We always get, let's say, general lighting for the entire company, power for the entire setup together. But we have to allocate it to different departments in order to figure out how much has each department contributed to that expense. Okay, and that is what overheads does. Overheads allocates all these indirect expenses, indirect wages, indirect labor, etc., etc., to different departments so that the cost, the benefit of each department is available to us. Okay, specially useful for big enterprises which have different departments. Okay, let's now get into the basics of overheads. Through this example, I'm very sure 90% of overheads is done. You only need to go through the basics with me to be sure about what exactly did we do through this example. Okay, so prime cost, we have already done prime cost before. All the direct expenses, direct material, labor expenses are called as prime cost. And then you have overhead cost, all the expenses on indirect labor, material expenses, they come together and create overhead cost. Okay, accounting and control of overhead cost is more complex than other elements of cost, because overheads are indirect costs which cannot be conveniently allocated to cost units, because you cannot allocate conveniently overheads to cost units. Therefore, their accounting becomes more complex, and that is what happened when we discussed the first example. It was a complex phenomenon. Okay, and it gets more complex as we get into the details of overheads, but we are not going to get into those complex situations or questions because they're not expected in the exam. We're going to stick with the basics. Now, classification of overheads. There are different ways of classifying overhead costs. Let's say you get rent as rupees, let's say 10,000. There are different methods you can use to classify that rent to different departments. Okay, there can be a function based classification, element based classification, or variability or behavior based classification. Let's understand them one by one. What is function based classification? You divide overheads into three different parts: production, administrative, and selling and distribution. Whether your overhead was a selling and distribution overhead, administrative overhead, or a production overhead, that is the division that you make. Let's say a rent of rupees 5,000 was paid in a building wherein only the administrative staff sits. So that rent will become overhead of only the administration department. Okay, so administration, based upon function of that overhead, it is being allocated. I hope it's very, very clear. The next is element wise classification. Whether that overhead or expense was on indirect material, was indirect wages, or indirect expenses. So rent, again, rent will come here, right? Indirect expense, rent is not a wage, rent is not a material, rent is an indirect expense. So all the rents, whether it is from the administrative department, selling and distribution department, production department, if it is an overhead, it goes under indirect expenses in one category. Okay, indirect material, let's say stationery of administrative department, stationery of selling and distribution department, stationery of, let's say, in my company, content creation department, all the stationery will come under one hand, indirect material. This is based upon element, not based upon function, based upon element. Okay, let's say foreman's pay, indirect wages. So let's say in my my office, there is a maid which comes and cooks for some people, and she cleans up the entire, a spot boy kind of a person. So his expenses or her expenses will be called indirect wages. Okay, and not depending upon where are those expenses being incurred, whether they're spent on content department, whether they're spent on the sales department, whether they're spent on the tech department, whether the accounting department, they will always be called indirect wages. So this is element wise classification. And the third is classification according to behavior or variability. Behavior ke basis pe jo classification hota hai, That is the third type. Okay. Now, based upon behavior, overhead can be fixed, variable or semi-variable. Rent, you have to pay every month, no matter you're functioning or not functioning. Let's say tomorrow I have to, a lot of offices closed down due to COVID. Even then, we had to pay our rents. Okay. Managerial salaries have to be paid even if, let's say, production is not happening or something bad has happened. Let's say depreciation. Okay. Let's say you have purchased a building for your workhouse, for I've created a studio. Okay. So even if I don't teach, I was not teaching using this screen during COVID lockdown, even then depreciation was charged on this. Okay. Because it was getting obsolete by a certain proportion every month or every year, right? So these are fixed overheads. Then there will be variable overheads, which matter or change directly with the work that is being done. Indirect material, indirect labor, light. So when the offices were not working due to COVID, then all the light expenses here were not happening. So this was a variable overhead, which was changing in direct proportion with the amount of work being done. And then you have semi-variable overheads. For example, in certain departments, what happens? We will pay you a fixed salary of, let's say, 20,000 and a variable salary on per unit basis. Let's say for every extra hour worked, you will get rupees 500, something like that. Okay. So this is semi-variable overhead. Okay. Variable also, fixed also, both are included. Then there are steps in overhead distribution. How do you distribute overheads? The example that we took, we actually distributed overheads, right? Rent was 5,000. We distributed it among five departments. This is what this is talking about. So I've shown you the practical example. Through that practical example, all these things have already been covered. First of all, you classify the overheads. So we classified, okay, rent rates 5,000. Depreciation of machinery 10,000. This was the classification. Then we allocated to various departments, right? We allocated all the overheads to ABCDE, five departments. Reapportionment of service department cost to production departments. This happens at times, but this is not going to be studied by us in detail because it's very complex and not expected in the exam. However, what this means is whatever expenditure is being incurred in service department will be then allocated again to production departments, okay? And then absorption of overheads of each production department in cost units, not very important. Let's leave that, okay? You just have to understand, you just have to understand the basic, functioning, and you understood it through the example itself. So the second point here is classification was the first point. Second point was allocation and apportionment. Which is also called as primary distribution or departmentalization. Okay. This point is important because we need to understand, first of all, the difference between allocation and apportionment. Okay. And secondly, departments, there are production and service departments, which I clearly demarcated in the example itself. Okay. So taking my example again, content creation and teaching will be production department. And sales department, marketing, tech, accounting, all this will be service department. Okay. Now, what is the difference between allocation and apportionment? Certain items which can be directly identified with a particular department or cost center is called as allocation. Let's say you have rent of, let's say, 5,000. Okay. And let's say there are two offices. One office is, let's say, for content creators, and another office is, let's say, for accountants, for the techies. I'm talking about a service industry like myself, service company like myself, techies. Then there is a marketing, there is a creative team. Okay, these are, all of these sit together, let's say, and the content team sits together. So rent is 5,000, let's say, for these two offices, and it is 2,500 for each office. Okay. So now the rent classification or allocation has been done very clearly, 2,500 each. But however, let's say there's another situation. They're sitting in the same office. Rent is 5,000 complete. And there are, let's say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 departments. This means the classification will be, or allocation will be 1000 for each department. That will be called as apportionment, because there is no clear way of classifying or allocating a certain amount of cost to each department. Okay, we don't know whether content department is taking more space than all these four departments or not. How much space is each department utilizing? We don't know that. If we had known that, then it will again come to allocation. So whenever the overhead cost cannot be directly charged to a department or a cost center, whenever there is a confusion, okay, how much to charge to this department, how much is to be charged to this department out of this entire cost, then we call it apportionment, otherwise we call it allocation. Okay, I hope that's clear. What are the principles of allocation? Service or use, survey method, ability to pay method. What is service or use? How much is it used? Survey method, you create a survey and you try to identify, okay, this much is allocated, this much should be allocated. Ability to pay, let's say majority of the money comes from the sales department. Content department is not creating or not earning any money. It is just creating content and giving it to students. Similarly, the tech department is not creating any money, not creating any revenue directly. Therefore, what is the ability to pay of each department? Okay, accounting department, it is always saving money and not contributing to your revenues. So often they are ignored, okay, because their ability to pay is less. So if their ability to pay is less, then the apportionment of the cost to their department will also be less only. Okay, these are the different examples of basis of apportionment. In the first example, only we understood very clearly basis of apportionment. Let's say rent humne dekha tha, we had seen that based upon floor area it was divided. We had seen electricity lighting, based upon light points it was divided. Okay, we had seen depreciation, based upon value it was divided. Okay, so these are the basis of apportionment of cost to different overhead classifications. Okay, I hope that's clear now. It's very, very simple. The basics are very, very simple. Through the example, it must have become very, very clear. Then there is absorption or application of overhead. How do you absorb overheads in each different departments? In that example, it was direct based on rupees. Therefore, the absorption was simple. It might become difficult otherwise. Okay. So the step you take. So there are two steps. First step is computation of overhead absorption rate. So you identify the overhead absorption rate, that is total overheads upon total units of base. First of all, you identify what is the base. So base is basis, that is, this is the basis. Okay. So total units of base upon total overheads upon total units of base. We did this in our first example also. Let's go back to that example. Rent wale mein dekhte hain. In rent, the basis was floor space, right? What is the rent here? The rent here is 5000 and the floor space is 10,000. This is not in rupees, this is space. So this is space, 10,000 square feet maybe. Okay, and then there is division. Each department is taking this much space out of 10,000, let's say, square feet of floor space. Okay, so there's apportionment. The base is 10,000. The base is 10,000 here. The percentage is also available here, 20% now, 2000 upon 10,000. And the overall overhead which is to be allocated is 5000. So it will be 5000 for A, it will be 5000 upon 10,000, right, into 2000. Okay, so 5 into 2, so 1000. Out of 5000, 1000 rupees will go to department A. This is what is the first point that I was talking about. Computation of overhead absorption rate. Absorption rate nikal ke humne. Then application of rates to cost unit. Overhead rate nikala humne. Rate was 5000 upon 10,000. What is this? 1 by 2. 1 by 2 is the rate and you multiply it by units of base. So 1 by 2 into units of base was for A 2000. Now we get the total allocation or application of rate to cost unit. To department A, the allocation is 1000 out of 5000. I hope it's clear. Both these steps we already took in the first example itself. Then there are two kinds of rates in overheads. There are actual rates and predetermined rates. Of course, predetermined rates are better than actual rates. Actual rates are post-mortem rates, which are basically when the expenses overheads have already been incurred. These are the actual overheads. Actual amount of overheads or actual base is actual rate. Okay. Actual rates cannot be computed until the end of accounting period. So after the end of accounting period only, you will come to know what are the actual expenses, actual overheads. These rates do not provide any basis for cost control because they are available to the company at the end of the accounting year or financial year. That's why they don't help in cost control. Okay, cost control is enabled through predetermined rates only. Okay, this year rent expense should be 5,000 per year. Okay, the rent expense should be 5,000. That is a predetermined overhead on rent. Whereas the actual was, let's say, 4,000. Okay, so then you compare actual with the predetermined and you identify why was there a variation between them. And that comes under variable accounting. I hope that's the absorption and variable. I hope that's also, you also remember that. Okay. Blanket and multiple rates. This is just for understanding purpose. There's some problem in the PPT. Don't worry about that. Blanket rate is, a blanket overhead rate is a single overhead rate for the entire factory. So single overhead rate. So in the first example, we had multiple rates. For rent, we had floor area. For depreciation, we had the value of machinery as the overhead rate, right? But there may be cases where only one rate is used for the entire, for all the overheads. That will be called as a blanket rate. And multiple rates is when different rates are used for different departments, for different expenses. I hope that's clear. Okay. When predetermined rate is employed, overheads absorbed may not be equal to the amount of actual overhead. So what happens is you predetermined that the expense on rent in this year will be, let's say, rupees 7,000. However, the actual overhead expense this year was only 5,000. Okay. So there's a gap of 2,000. You over absorbed 2,000 as your rent. However, the actual rent expense came out to be much less at 5,000. Okay. So there can be a difference between predetermined and actual overheads, which can result in into either under or over absorption. In both the cases, you have to make the correction, right? I hope that's clear. Faulty estimation. So what are the causes of under or over absorption? The estimation is faulty. The quantity of output is faulty. You thought that in this year we'll be selling 2 million biscuits, but we'll be producing 2 million units, but you could produce only 1.5 million units of biscuits. So faulty estimation of quantity of output, how much are you going to produce? Seasonal fluctuation in the amount of overheads in certain industries. In winters, you require heaters. In summers, you require ACs. ACs consume, let's say, more power than heaters. So your rent expense is going to increase in summers, okay, much more. So that's seasonal fluctuation. Unforeseen changes in the production capacity. Capacity suddenly changed, increased or decreased. Let's say one major machinery suddenly broke down and you don't have the money to buy another capital asset or to repair it. So unforeseen changes. Unexpected changes in the methods of production affecting changes in the amount of overheads. Methods of production that you're following have to be changed because of certain, let's say, obsolescence in the industry or certain changes in the industry. Okay. Accounting treatment of under or over absorption. Whenever there is an under or over absorption, you can follow any one of the three methods. First of all, you can write off to costing and profit and loss account. Let's say you've expected the rent expense to be, let's say, 4,000. But the actual rent expense came out to be rupees 5,000. So there is an under absorption of 1,000. So what you will do, you will charge 1,000 remaining under absorption as a loss or as an expense in the profit and loss account directly. You will not allocate it to different departments. You'll just charge it to profit and loss account. Okay. Or you can carry it over to the next year. Okay. We have under absorbed rent expense by 1,000. Let us carry it over to the next year. Next year, our projection is that the expense on rent will be 6,000 per annum. We will add 1,000 as this year's expense. So next year's projection comes out to be rupees 7,000. This is carrying it over to the next year. Or you use supplementary rates. Let's take an example to understand supplementary rates. What exactly happens in supplementary rates? It is followed when the amount of under or over absorbed overheads is significant. When there is a significant amount of under or over absorption, then use of supplementary rates is followed. Okay. In order to adjust the under or over absorbed overhead, a supplementary rate is calculated. You calculate a supplementary rate, and based upon that rate, you allocate your under or over absorbed overhead. Example lete hain, very simple example, it will be very clear. The predetermined overhead rate is rupees 5 per machine hour. So this is the predetermined overhead rate. There is an under or over absorption in this rate. So we will add or subtract a supplementary rate, whatever that supplementary rate comes out to be. Okay. And that supplementary rate will also be in per machine hour. So it is rupees per machine hour, right? This is also clear. So this is what we have to calculate. Actual machine hours are given as 1500. Actual overheads are given as 9000. Overheads absorbed are given as 7500. So there is under absorption. Actual overheads were more than the overheads absorbed. Overheads absorbed based on predetermined basis. So there is a gap of how much? 1500. 1500 is under absorbed overheads. We have to absorb it. When you are absorbing something that is not being absorbed, you add it to an expense, right? Machine hours will go in denominator, rupees will go in numerator. So 1500 upon 1500, under absorption 1500, supplementary rate will be under absorbed overhead, which is 1500 upon actual machine hours, which is also 1500. So it comes out to be rupees 1 per machine hour. So supplementary rate is rupees 1 per machine hour, predetermined overhead rate is rupees 5, actual overhead rate after adding the under absorbed rate comes out to be 5 plus 1, rupees 6 per machine hour. I hope that's clear. This is all there is to how under or over absorption is to be adjusted by calculating a supplementary rate. Costing and P&L account and allocation to next year's account, I hope it's clear. I've already explained it. Although it's written here, I don't think there is any need for it. So this was the entire overhead. This is all you need to understand in overheads. I will of course be taking certain questions from overheads, and through those questions, it will become all the more clear. Okay, it's a very, very easy topic if you understand the basics of overheads, the fundamentals of overheads. If you don't understand the fundamentals only, then it might create a problem. It might become difficult for you to understand or remember. Okay, I hope it's clear. All the very best, guys. Take care. Bye bye.